all the members of the family of the Pandavas were completely dependent on the protection of the Lord, and therefore the Lord protected all of them in all circumstances. The Lord protects everyone, but one who depends completely upon Him is especially looked after by the Lord. The father is more attentive to the little son who is exclusively dependent on the father. So in this verse, we are seeing, as Prabhupada explains, that Lord Krishna, after the battle of Kurukshetra, is getting ready to go back to Dwaraka. And as soon as he was about to leave, after he mounted the chariot, he saw Uttara coming in a hurry towards him. So in the purport of this verse, Prabhupada explains how a father is equal to all his children, but he will be exclusively inclined a bit more than other children to that little son or a daughter who is showing dependency on him. This is how many times people ask this question, that why is Lord cruel? Why is Lord partial? Some of them are born rich, some of them don't even have a square meal. So all these disparities in the world, it makes us think. And that is why many of the intellectual class of men ask this question, why is Lord partial? So Prabhupada explains that he is not partial, he is equal to everyone. And in fact, Krishna himself declares in the Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 9, 9th chapter, 29th verse, he says, Samoham sarva bhuteshu, name dveshyosti na priyaha. Krishna is telling, Samoham sarva bhuteshu, he is equal to all living entities. Name dveshyosti, he is not envious to anybody, or name na priyaha, he is not inclined to anybody, but ye bhajanti tu mam bhaktya, but one who is rendering devotional service, bhakti, then te tashu chapyaham. So he is a friend to Krishna and Krishna is that I am a friend to him. So this verse, many times people say it is contradicting. Krishna in the first line is saying that I am equal to everyone, I am not partial. But second line he says, those who are surrendering to me, those who are engaged in my devotional service, I take care of them specially. So Prabhupada explains in the purport to that verse that just like cloud, when the cloud comes down as rain, it doesn't have any reservations, it falls everywhere. But how much a rock can absorb the water, how much a land can absorb the water, and how much a body of water can absorb the water. So it makes a difference. So it pours equally on a rock, land and water. So, but the amount, the receptivity, the power of receptivity varies between a rock, land and water. In case of water it is 100% and in case of rock it is 0% or probably 1%. So, the Lord's mercy, it is equally available to all of us. But all it makes a difference is how far we are inclined to receive the mercy of the Lord. Now, for example, the city of Bangalore has 100 plus crores of population. But here we see about a few hundred people sitting here. Now, can we say that we are partial to these 120 people sitting over here? It was a choice. It was merely a choice. So one may question that, you know, some people against their wish, they are admitted in the hospital or they are undergoing such suffering, so they don't have a free will. No, they had a free will which they had misused in the past, and today that circle of free will has compressed, it has diminished. So all of us in one sense have the choice, power of choice, freedom of choice. The way we employ the choice, the free will, it shapes up our destiny in the future. Similarly, this organization, ISKCON, it's open for everybody. Only a few of us are practicing devotional service. That doesn't mean that this organization is partial to only select a few of them. No, it was never the prerogative of the organization. It was an individual's choice. So therefore, similarly, Krishna, he is open to give his mercy. He is available to give his mercy to all of us. But it depends whether we are willing to take that mercy or not. And when we start showing interest, he will reciprocate to us. And this act of reciprocation of the Lord is sometimes termed as partiality by the Lord, by some intellectual class of men who do not know this science. As Krishna says, ye yatha mam prapadyante tam stataiva bhajami aham. As you surrender, so shall I reciprocate. So the more is our surrender, the more is the reciprocation of the Lord. So that doesn't mean that the Lord is partial to us. We decided, we chose, we used our free will to surrender unto the Lord, and therefore Lord is reciprocating. The law of reciprocity, it's basically coming from the Lord. So when we say, like as this verse says, the Lord gives protection to those who are dependent on Him. The moment we hear of the term protection, all of us, we have different connotations of that word protection. Many times we see, when we go out for preaching, meeting donors, meeting people, meeting college students, they all have this innate question in them. Will Lord protect me if I take to this process? So will Lord give me protection? Will He safeguard me? So when they ask this question, what is the ideology or what is the thought process that is going on in them about this concept of protection? What are they expecting out of when they say that will Lord protect me? What is that they are expecting? Mostly it is in the material realm. Even if you see some elderly parents and who have been, you know, born and brought up in the theistic culture and who have a culture and tradition of worshipping the Lord at their homes, if you see, all that they pray is, O Lord, and if he is a young student and our prayers of protection starts from a very young age and it goes on, 10th standard, I should get good percentage, then 2nd PU, good college, then a competitive exam, good score, then get into a good college, and then a suitable offer, that a package, and then a good alliance, and then good children, and the cycle continues. Children's education, children's studies, children's marriage, grandchildren, it goes until we are able to foresee whatever generations. So this concept of well-being, it's misunderstood by the people in general. So when they say, and in fact even till date, 90% of the people, or probably even more, who throng to the temples or who practice devotion, it is at this level. Of course, that is not completely zero. As Krishna himself says that chaturvidha bhajante mam. So the four kinds of people, artho, who are distressed, artharthi, who are in financial need, and jignasu, who are inquisitive, and the jnani, the fourth class. So definitely who are distressed, who are in need of money, who are inquisitive, yes, these are the people who come to the Lord, and that is accepted by the Lord. But then that is not the summum bonum of it. Our understanding of protection should not be limited to well-being of my body, well-being of myself, well-being of my extended self, my relatives, my parents, my children, my spouse. So well-being of these things is considered protection by the Lord. And if any of these things get little bit deviated, we ask the Lord, why me? We will never ask the Lord, why me, when we are in good times. We will never thank the Lord, why we have given good birth, good education, good parentage, good culture, good job, good family. We never thank the Lord. But in any of these equations, if a little bit deviation we see, we ask the Lord, why me? Why is not Lord protecting me? I have been engaged all my life in serving the Lord, in believing that Lord exists, but Lord did not protect me. So what are they basically referring to when they say that Lord did not protect me is something very much in the material realm. They never understood the protection of the Lord is something beyond that. they are able to foresee the reciprocation of the Lord only in terms of well-being of the self and the extended self. If everything is going smooth, they feel, yes, yes, Lord is there, God is there. And if at all they go through a difficulty and they successfully come out of that, Lord is there. Oh Lord, you have proved that you are there. But something goes wrong, he turns into an atheist. There is no God. Because he did not get what he wanted. So that desire he did not get fulfilled, that craving did not get satisfied. So basically our understanding of protection is just limited to the material realm. But what does Srila Prabhupada tell regarding this concept of protection? Let us hear from Srila Prabhupada. The purpose of the entire creation of God is to rectify the living entity's tendency to enjoy without the Lord. And therefore, the particular punishment given for the sinful activity is specifically designed to curtail the mentality that produced the activity. So basically, these are the quotes which are picked up in the context that when we are tormented by difficulty, some unexpected disasters in our life, we generally say that, you know, we generally question the Lord, why me and why have you allowed me to undergo this suffering? So what Prabhupada is explaining us the science of receiving or understanding how a devotee should feel, how a sadhaka should understand when he is tormented, when he is bombarded with difficulties, some reversals of life. What is the state of mind of a devotee much against the state of mind of a karmi or a materialist? That person, as we were discussing, he only feels that when things are going good, it is a protection of the Lord. Otherwise, he takes it as a that Lord doesn't exist. But we being devotees of the Lord, we should hear from the Shastras and from the Sadhus and from the Guru that what is, when we are undergoing difficulty, definitely for sure, just for the fact that we have taken up devotional service doesn't completely absolve us of the material difficulties. We still have our problems with the family, in the job, in our personal life, with related to body, all that is continuing. But what is our way of looking at that things? So Prabhupada is telling, when a devotee undergoes a difficulty, he should understand that this material world is created for suffering only. Dukkhalayam ashashvatam. It is the certification given by the manufacturer of the world. So you can't think something else. If you are trying to still look for happiness in the material realm, we are prone to be deluded. We are prone to be cheated because the manufacturer of the world is telling this is dukkhalayam ashashvatam. So, but Prabhupada is explaining here, and who is put into this dukkhalayam ashashvatam? Those living entities who wanted to enjoy independent of the Lord. When we had our dependency on the Lord, we were all happy. But at one point of time, we thought, why should Krishna alone enjoy? Why not me also enjoy? Me also enjoy in connection with the Lord is still approved. It doesn't mean it is like Prabhupada explains, in the material world, when we hear the concept of a master and a servant, it's something very disgusting. It's something not very palatable. Because master always lords over and servant is always lorded over. So it's not very pleasant to be a servant. Nobody introduces himself to be the servant of somebody. So it's not a very honorable position or the designation to be a servant. So but our identity of servant is only limited to the material world. But in the spiritual world, a servant of the Lord is as equally happy as that of the Lord. But somehow that thought crept into our mind that why not me enjoy independently. So then Lord, because you have got a desire, because you have got the free will, Lord has to facilitate that free will. So therefore he has created this material world and he has sent us here to try out. When you are thoroughly frustrated and convinced that this is not a place where I will be happy, at that time Krishna will start reciprocating to you. So that is what Prabhupada is explaining. So some of the other quotations that Srila Prabhupada tells that how devotees should take sufferings. The Lord therefore creates a particular situation to eradicate this remaining enjoying spirit. Somehow, although we are devotees, we have still some amount of enjoying spirit. We try to somehow dovetail and we still try to look for enjoying spirit. So therefore, Prabhupada is telling, the Lord will create a particular situation so that even that little spirit of enjoying becomes eradicated. This unhappiness suffered by a sincere devotee is not technically a karmic reaction. It is rather the Lord's special mercy for inducing his devotee to completely let go of the material world and return home back to Godhead. So Prabhupada is telling, it is an indirect way of inspiring and encouraging us. So otherwise we will make plans here and we will settle down here. That was not the purpose intended by the Creator. So therefore Prabhupada is telling, when a devotee faces some reversals in life, he should understand that it is the special mercy of the Lord. Of course, this has no contextual reference to the karmis. They are just purely suffering their reactions to their previous actions. This is in the context of devotees, in the context of practicing devotees, sadhakas, referring to all of us. So when we face difficulties, we should take that it is the mercy of the Lord that it is sanctioned to me, and it would reinforce the fact that this is not the place for us to inhabit. Further, Srila Prabhupada tells, a sincere devotee earnestly desires to go back to the Lord's abode. Therefore, he willingly accepts the Lord's merciful punishment and continues offering respects and obeisances to the Lord with his heart, words and body. So Prabhupada is clearly emphasizing that when we come across reversals, we take it as Lord's merciful punishment and we continue to offer our respects and obeisances to the Lord. Generally what we do is, when we come across some difficulty, we distance ourselves from the Lord. When things are going smooth, we have belief in the protection of the Lord, because our idea of protection is only limited to that much. So therefore, Prabhupada is, as we heard all these quotes of Prabhupada, it is very clear that our understanding of protection should be something different than that of the outside materialists. So then what is that understanding that we have to embark upon? Our understanding of devotional service is, we'll have to be least bothered by the material difficulties. That doesn't mean that we don't handle them. As a matter of duty, you have difficulties at your workplace, you should try to solve them. But that is on a vyavaharic plane. There are two things that Prabhupada explains. One is vyavaharic and the other is paramarthic. Vyavaharic is something to do with the outside world. It's the business dealings of a devotee. Means we come across, suppose a person is running a factory. He has a labor shortage. He has to look for ways and means to find the labor. That's vyavaharik. But then that difficulty should not grow to such an extent that it infringes upon the paramarthic zone of the devotee, and he starts feeling that, why should I chant? I can't chant, I am busy, I have to look for labor. So that completely two complete things should be separated. Vyavaharik is different. Yes, you have problems, you are having ill health, you are not keeping well, you are having fever, or you are suffering from some disease. Yes, that is vyavaharik plane. This body is suffering. So you will have to go to a doctor, you have to find the right source of medication, you will have to look for alternative methodologies, you will have to try to get cured of that ailments. But that's on a vyavaharik plane. So we are spirit souls, we are completely different. So our paramarthic duties, to chant, to read, to render service, should not get affected by the vyavaharik. So that's completely, so our understanding of protection of the Lord is, we should pray to protect our devotional service. That's the real prayer of a devotee. We should pray to the Lord, O Lord, please protect my devotional service. In fact, Srila Prabhupada says in one lecture, for an aspiring devotee, there is nothing called hell or heaven. Because he is praying to the Lord, O Lord, doesn't matter where you send me, he is not even bothered about liberation. At least some thieves, no, they always want, give me moksha. They are all after moksha and things like that. But what Prabhupada has given us is something unique. He says devotees are do not even want moksha. So what they want, they say, they pray to the Lord, as long as you are able to give me the remembrance of your lotus feet, do not matter where you send me, whether hell or heaven. So Prabhupada explains the secret why a devotee considers himself like that is, the moment he remembers the lotus feet of the Lord, he really, you know, surmounts the, he comes out of the material plane. And in the external situation, you may be in hell, you may be in heaven, doesn't matter. But as long as he is remembering the lotus feet of the Lord, he is situated in Vaikuntha. So it really doesn't matter what is your external situation. So this is the prayer of a aspiring, of an interested devotee. Devotees interested in advancement. So they always pray, O Lord, protect my devotional service. And in the process of our discharge of duties in the world, sometimes reversals can happen. So, but he will not be disturbed by that. He will constantly pray to the Lord that please protect my devotional service. Never take me away. Never give me forgetfulness of your service. There is an English proverb which says, the mills of God grind slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. The mills of God grind slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. Which means, when we undergo a difficulty, it really doesn't fit into the scheme of things that we are exposed to. And this is again why people ask, I have been doing all good things in my life. Why am I coming across such difficulty? But this proverb says that the Lord's activity, the Lord's plan of scheme of things, it's perfect. The mills of God grind exceedingly fine. There is absolutely no scope for a blunder, for a mistake. There is nothing called by chance. So in other words, whatever is happening to us in our lives, it is the plan of the Lord. And especially if you are a devotee, practicing devotional service, trying to follow the principles of Bhakti Yoga, then you should be 100% convinced that Lord has taken charge of your lives. Sometimes people have this misconception. The Lord will take charge only when we become pure devotee. No, not true. This is not the Bhagavata philosophy. The correct understanding is, the moment we start interacting with the Lord through chanting the holy names, offering arati, taking darshan, honoring prasadam, the moment we start the process, the Lord starts reciprocating. He starts taking charge of your life. Of course, the question is, how much charge does it take? And the answer is, as we have discussed, as much as you show your surrender. So, but the process starts. The Lord steers your life towards a meaningful end. So, which means, we need not be worried as to why these things are happening to me. And you know, sometimes the devotee also, although practicing for a long time, he is really, you know, he doesn't have an answer to this question. Why is this thing happening to me? Some of these questions remains unanswered for quite some time. But then our business is not to find an answer for that question, but to increase our surrender to the Lord and thereby experience His reciprocation. And this reciprocation of the Lord, we have heard in innumerable pastimes. One such pastime of the Lord is connected to Lord Jagannath. You know Lord Jagannath, recently we had Rath Yatra and then the Bahuda Yatra. So Jagannath is the most merciful form of the Lord. So this is the pastime of Jagannath related to one of his great devotee by name Raghudasa. So Raghudasa, who lived several hundred years ago in the area of Puri, Jagannath Puri, he had his house very close to the Simhadwara, and he was a devotee who ardently worshipped Lord Rama. So he was a very great devotee of Rama. Once when he went to the temple of Lord Jagannath gave him darshan as Lord Ramachandra. So from that day, this devotee became even more devoted to that form of the Lord, Lord Jagannath, and he developed Sakya Rasa with the Lord. He became a very intimate friend to the Lord, and he started visiting every day, and he used to worship Lord Jagannath as Lord Ramachandra, his beloved Lord, and it was happening. It so happened that once this Raghudasa, he made a flower garland and he with all devotion and he brought it to the Jagannath temple and he wanted that to be offered to the Lord. When the pujaris received the garland, they rejected the garland. They denied his proposal to offer that to the Lord. And they gave a reason that the garland was made of a string, which was the string that was used to make the garland was nothing but the bark of a banana tree. And because of that reason, the priests denied offering that garland to Lord Jagannath. So this devotee was completely demotivated. He felt baffled. He felt completely down. And because he came that his friend will, because he was in Sakya Rasa with the Lord, so he always thought about Lord as his very close friend. And just like when a friend denies our offer, how we feel completely devastated. So Raghudasa felt like that. So with no other option, he left the place, and somehow he could not come out of that thought that whatever offering of devotion he gave, that was not accepted by the Lord. And he started continuously meditating upon that aspect, and slowly tears started flowing out of his ears. He wept and sobbed throughout the day, and he also denied taking any food. So he was completely on fast for that whole day, crying, weeping, sobbing, not eating any food. He was completely devastated. On the other side, the priests have denied Raghudasa's offer of offering of garland, and they are continuing with the daily rituals of the bhogas and other things. So in the evening, that was the time when the bhoga was finished offering. And there is something, one arati called Bada Arati, if I am right, in the night. That's the last arati in the Jagannath temple. So at that time, the priests were getting the Lord ready for the arati. And once the arati was performed, they had to dress the Lord with a special dress, new dress, and a special dressing of flower garlands. So the garland, the priest who had that service, he put on the fresh set of cloths on the Lord Jagannath's body, and then he put the garland, and the garland fell down. And then he tried once more, it fell down. Then he felt, what is this strange? So then he did something, that he tucked the garland ends to the cloth and did something to wear it to Jagannath. The garland fell down. And then he called other priests, and the head priest came. So they all tried to put the garland is falling down. Then the priest decided, one end of the garland was held by some priests, and the other end were by some priests, and they tried to do something and wear it on Jagannath, it is still falling down. They could not understand what is the reason Lord Jagannath is not accepting their garland. By then they had tried enough number of times, and that was enough to convince the head pujari there that we have offended Lord Jagannath. Lord Jagannath is angry on us for some reason, and therefore is not accepting our garland. So, but they did not know what to do further. So they decided to sleep in the temple that night and decided to fast till Lord Jagannath gives them the direction. And incidentally, as we all know, Lord never delays in reciprocating to his devotee. The delay is always from our end in surrendering to the Lord. So that night itself, Lord Jagannath comes in the dream of the head pujari, and he says, I have felt bad because you have refused the garland that was made with love and devotion. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachati. The bhakti is an essential element. It is not that Krishna is hungry after a few fruits or flowers that you are offering to him. Krishna's position is millions of Lakshmis are waiting for an opportunity to serve him. Sahasra Lakshmis are waiting. So what is our offering? But whatever we are offering, the quantum doesn't matter. The bhakti, bhaktya, when you offer even a fruit, even a water, with bhakti the Lord will accept. So the Lord Jagannath told in the dream of that head pujari that he had made that garland out of love and devotion, but you have denied based on some principle. So please get it corrected and then I'll accept all your offerings. Because if when his garland was denied, I can't be happy while accepting all your garlands. So when Jagannath told that in the dream of the head pujari, all the pujaris rushed to Raghudasa's home and they lovingly accepted that garland, upon which Raghudasa felt ecstatic. He saw that reciprocation of the Lord and he was completely in trance. So now, one may question, we are not experiencing such reciprocation. Raghudasa experienced it. So therefore, he could. But then, the question is, are we offering that with our love and devotion? That's the question to be asked for ourselves. And definitely, nobody can claim that the Lord is not reciprocating. The Lord is definitely reciprocating. The very fact that all of us are here today, it's a fact that Lord has reciprocated to us. Unless the Lord gives the sanction, not a blade of grass can move without his sanction. And if you have come here, and if you are rendering services in the temple to the Lord, if you are chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, if you are reading Srila Prabhupada's books, that's definitely the reciprocation of the Lord. While millions of devotees are not able to do that, why are we the selected, chosen ones? At this point, we don't question the Lord, why me? We only question the Lord, why me? When we have some difficulty. Why are we not realizing that this is have been handpicked by the Lord? So we say, usually when we are discussing or conversing, we say, he is one in millions. We are that one in millions. We are one in billions. The Lord has reciprocated in all our lives. Our lives have changed. So this is the greatness of having associated with a movement like this. And Srila Prabhupada, what he has done, it's something very unique. That is how somehow when devotees, we go outside, like recently I had been to Andhra, the people ask me, what are you doing? When I say that I am a part of a temple, so they understand something. And most of them, 99% of what they understand is what I realized when he introduced me, he understood me and introduced me to the other person. So when he asked me the question, I told I do service in the temple. And when another person came, he was introducing me. So he introduced me as, he does puja to the Lord. He's a pujari there in the temple at Bangalore. Because people's conception of a temple, what will you all do? Even otherwise some of our donors ask us, what will you all do in the temple from morning to evening? You only doing pujas, aartis? So they can't conceive of an organization which can offer multitude of services as an organization like ISKCON is offering to the humanity. Therefore, ISKCON, many times Prabhupada says, ISKCON, as constituted by Srila Prabhupada, is not just an organization, it is an incarnation of the Lord for the suffering humanity. It is the reciprocation of the Lord for the fallen conditioned souls. We are able to change our paradigm. We are able to think beyond our body only because of the mercy of a devotee like Srila Prabhupada. So therefore, as we are discussing our understanding of protection, what is our understanding of protection? Protection of devotional service. That should be our understanding and that should be our prayer. And how is that affected? How are you conveying to the Lord? How are you communicating to the Lord that yes, I am interested in your protecting my devotional service? How are you doing that? By chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. There is yet another one pastime of the Lord in the case of a devotee by name Puntanam. So this devotee called Puntanam lived in Guruvayur. He lived in a village about a few hundred miles away from Guruvayur, and he was a very ardent, he was an ardent devotee of the Lord, and he was visiting the temple of Guruvayur without fail, every month without fail. That was his regular schedule. Every once in a month he used to come to the temple of Guruvayur and he used to render his prayers, and he served the Lord for 90 odd years. And the speciality of his devotional service is he used to recite the verses of Bhagavatam in Malayalam for the pleasure of Lord Guruvayurappan. It so happened that once while he was traveling from his home to the temple of Guruvayur, he had to pass, the path is separated by a few hundred kilometers, and it requires that he traverse that path through a dense forest. So even though he is traveling in the daytime, there is hardly any scope for light, it's very dark. And it so happened that once when he was traveling through this dense dark forest en route to the temple of Guruvayur, he was attacked all of a sudden by a group of dacoits, robbers. So then the robbers demanded the devotee Puntanam's possessions, and Puntanam readily gave away his money and the ring that he had on his hand. He gave all his precious belongings that he had. So but the dacoits were not satisfied. They took the money, they took the ring, but he was holding on to a small packet in his hand, and that he had firmly held in his armpit. He was trying to be very stiff on that. So the dacoits felt that there is something more valuable than this cash and the ring that he had handed over. He told, "Give me that, give me that." So then Puntanam requested that, "No, this is the book of Bhagavatam, and therefore I am trying to hold it. This is something, it's very close to my heart." So but somehow they were not in a bent of mind to believe Puntanam. So they were trying to snatch it, and Puntanam was refusing to give it away. And it so happened they forcibly snatched it from Puntanam. At that time, because the very scary thought of Puntanam's missing the Bhagavatam, he screamed out for the Lord. The moment he screamed for the Lord, he heard a horse coming very fiercely, and in that fear, even the robbers, they became completely fearful. They left all the belongings that they had collected, ring, cash, and including the book, and they ran away. And at that time, the Lord, they just heard actually the sound of a horse. But then when nothing came about, they again came back. So then again, see, still they had not opened. Basically that book Bhagavatam was covered in a cloth or something like that. So it was not visible to the dacoits that it is a Bhagavatam. They are thinking that it is something very, something very important for them as far as some opulence is concerned. So, but this time, again, Puntanam shouts for the help of the Lord, and this time one person did come on the back of the horse, and he fights the dacoits and he sends them back. And at that time, the person who came on the back of the horse, he recollects those articles from the robbers, dacoits, and gives it back to Puntanam. So in exchange of his help, was rendered by that person, Puntanam gives a ring to that person, and that person will introduce himself as a near minister in the nearby state, and then he leaves. So then Puntanam continues his travel towards Gurvayur. So now, this is all happening on the one side. On the other side, Lord Guruvayurappan comes in the dream of a head pujari. And he says, he orders the pujari that tomorrow morning when you open the altar, you will find a ring in my altar, and that ring you should take it and give it as my gift to a devotee by name Puntanam who will be coming here tomorrow. So the next day when Puntanam goes, the pujari finds him and he gives him. He was completely flabbergasted. Such is the reciprocation of the Lord that we all can experience, and we are experiencing the transformation what we have undergone. It's something unimaginable. People, when they ask our lifestyle, when you are able to describe that your lifestyle comprises of chanting, reading, serving, they say, okay. But when you say, we don't eat onion garlic, we don't take coffee tea, we don't go to movies, we don't go to hotels, we don't go to any IMAX, we don't go to anything. So they are thinking, is he leading a life? So they don't sometimes express it openly. So, but they just can't understand, because they can't think a person can live without them. But see all of our lives. What is considered impossible by them, we are practicing that. Isn't this the reciprocation of the Lord? The reciprocation of the Lord doesn't mean the reciprocation as experienced by Raghudasa or Puntanam. And also, of course, that doesn't mean that we cannot experience that kind of a reciprocation. Again, it depends on our inclination towards the Lord. So, we are already having this reciprocation that is, being experienced by all of us, because we are trying to follow in bits and pieces of what Srila Prabhupada has given us. But it so happens, we are not feeling that full capacity of that, because we sometimes become indifferent to the process. We think, yes, I know. How many rounds are you chanting? I am chanting 16 rounds for the past 20 years. You need not tell me. That's the subtle thing, of course. That will not be told. So, but I am chanting 16 rounds for the past 2 decades. But then what experience are we having in relation with the Lord is the question that we have to ask ourselves. Like we were discussing that we have to express our interest of being protected by the Lord in our devotional service by chanting. So how many of us today, feel that when we chant, we feel kind of happiness? We don't. Because it's like Shastras say, chanting is the fire of Sachidananda. Just like when there is fire, if you have to experience the heat, the blaze of the fire, you'll have to go nearby the fire. Suppose we stand 1 kilometer away from the fire. We can't experience anything, any quality of fire. So similarly, the chanting is considered to be the fire of Satchidananda. We all are, craving for Satchit and Ananda. All our lives is nothing but craving for Sat, Chit and Ananda. There is nothing more. This one sentence can summarize everything. We want to be eternal. We want to be knowledgeable. We want to be blissful. Ananda. We don't want distress. We don't want transient nature. So our cravingness of Satchidananda can be satisfied when we go closer to the chanting of the holy names. But when we chant, we have come across some kind of different kinds of chanting. I came across some article which says, when person one, there are different kinds of chanting that we are all doing right now. So two people are conversing. So the first person asks the second person, how are you? And when the second person is answering to that question, he starts, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama. And the second person is answering, because he has asked that question, how are you? The second person is answering, yeah, going dude, I am doing business. At this time, he is chanting. So then what about you? After asking the question, what about you? He starts chanting, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. So, I chant And when the other person speaks, sorry, I speak, and when the other person speaks, I chant. So this is not chanting, it's chatting. And today, one more famous type of chanting that we have come across practically is WhatsApp chanting. Very fast. People, you know, they just keep, not even two hands, one hand, on the left hand, because Japamala is there. People are not, people are very serious about chanting, they chant on the beats, not just like that. So Japamala is there, and that thread is hung around the neck, okay. And it's going on, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, fast, he's typing, I mean, it's something very unusual, multitasking, WhatsApp chanting, then laptop, and some people say that my chanting quality is improving because I'm seeing Krishna conscious videos and chanting. And sometimes that Krishna conscious videos, it's a big interpretation. Why? Because there'll be one whole video, in that video of 20 minutes, somewhere in the 11th minute, Krishna's photo is shown. So that becomes a Krishna conscious video. So even if it is 20 minutes Krishna consciousness, our chanting is not supposed to be seeing something and chanting. And some other, of course, this is most again popularly seen, newspaper or reading chanting. So we keep reading something and we be chanting, we will be chanting. So when we are doing all these processes of staying 1 kilometer away from the fire, how can we experience the reciprocation of the Lord? How can we ever feel what is the Satchidananda of Hare Krishna? We can never feel. Rather, if you have to hear from the Shastras on the importance of the Hare Krishna, the Shastras say, the Padma Purana says, Nama Chintamani Krishna's Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha Purna Shuddho Nitya Mukto Bhinnatvan Nama Naminaha, which means the holy name of Krishna is a transcendental wish-fulfilling gem. It is the embodiment of all consciousness and sentiments. It is complete. It is pure. Nitya Mukto, it is Purnaha. Purnaha is complete. Shuddha is pure. And it is ever free, Nitya Mukta, it is ever free, because Bhinnatvan Nama Naminaha, the holy name of Krishna is non-different from the person Krishna. So this is the understanding that we get, that from the Shastras, that chanting of the Hare Krishna Mantra, Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, is a Chintamani, it's a gem. But Nama Chintamani, that is why it is called Nama Chintamani, it's a wish fulfilling gem. But just like when a great diamond is given to a person who is a layman, there is a incident which I heard, that when you go, because layman means who doesn't have knowledge of something of that gem, so you give the gem and ask a washerman, what will you do? This is very hard. So he says, I will use it for washing clothes. And some other person is an illiterate and who works on the fields always, you ask him, what will you do with a gem, with a diamond? So he will say, I will use it for scraping my feet. So because a layman's knowledge of usage of a gem is only limited to that. He can't understand that a gem or diamond is worth a few billions. Similarly, we have got the access to this Nama Chintamani, the name which can fulfill all our desires. And when such an access is there to us, what is stopping from us from experiencing is our own inhibition, our own rejection to surrender unto the Lord. When we start taking this Hare Krishna mantra seriously, then we start experiencing all these qualities. Nitya Mukto, Purnaha, Shuddha, Rasa Vigraha. We are all craving for feelings, emotions, sentiments. It is an embodiment of all sentiments, Rasa Vigraha. So such is the power of this chanting, and that has been given to us by a great devotee like Srila Prabhupada. And Srila Prabhupada is not just one devotee. His position, it's unique. It's incomparable. And in fact, I wanted to share with you all three predictions on Prabhupada that was made by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. You can all see Bhaktivinoda Thakur's picture in the Gurumpara, fourth from the left. Prabhupada, his spiritual master Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, his spiritual master Gaur Kishwar Das Babaji Maharaj, and his spiritual master Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who is the pioneer of Krishna consciousness. So he made the predictions about Srila Prabhupada. He said, the first of the three predictions that he told, a personality will soon appear and he will travel all over the world to spread the teachings of Lord Chaitanya. So the first prediction was, a personality will come and who will travel all over the world to spread the teachings of Lord Chaitanya. And his second prediction, very soon the chanting of Harinama Sankirtana will be spread all over the world. When will the day come when people from America, England, France, Germany, Russia will take up karatalas and mrudangas and chant Hare Krishna in their towns? The third prediction, when will the day come when the fair-skinned foreigners will come to Sri Mayapur Dham and join with the Bengali Vaishnavas to chant Jaya Sachinandana, Jaya Sachinandana? When will that day be? These were the three predictions that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur made 1.5 centuries ago. And incidentally, Prabhupada, it is a great, so it is not, it's a perfect plan of the Lord. The very year Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakura sent his book to the overseas, he had written one book and he had sent that to the foreign country as his preaching tool. That very year, that is in the year 1896, Srila Prabhupada made his divine appearance, indicating that he is a instrument, tool in the hand of the Supreme Lord and the previous Acharyas. And Prabhupada, and it is also true that the will of Lord, and Prabhupada once said, when he was given credit to his success, Prabhupada was so humble, he told, the will of Lord Chaitanya, the desire of Bhaktivinoda Thakura, and the mercy of my spiritual master, Bhaktivinoda Thakura. This is what has helped me spread the Chaitanya's teachings. And today, in fact, it so happened that just 100 years from the day Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakura predicted, 1896 he predicted, 1986, we can see a huge congregation of devotees came to Mayapur and they chanted the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So that's the glory of Srila Prabhupada. And in fact, even Narada Muni had foretold the extraordinary worldwide preaching that is going to take part in the Padma Purana. In the Bhagavata Mahatmya, Narada Muni has made this prediction. He is addressing to Bhakti Devi, the embodiment, personification of Bhakti. So Narada Muni is addressing Bhakti Devi. O Bhakti Devi, there is no age like Kali Yuga. O Bhakti Devi, there is no age like Kali Yuga, because you will be established in every house and every heart. And hear my vow. So Narada Muni is making a vow. Hear my vow. What is the vow? If the preaching of Hare Krishna if I do not preach your message, subdue all other religions and make devotional fest. If I do not preach your message, subdue the other religions and make devotional practices predominant, then I shall not be considered servant of Hari. He is challenging. And he is making a prediction that a person will soon come who will fulfill this dream of mine. So with all this we can see how Prabhupada's divine appearance, it's all predicted by the great Acharyas in the past. He is not belonging to this world. He has given us an organization like this where we can come and express our devotional service of the Lord, render devotional service to the Lord. So he has come down only for taking us back home, back to Godhead. And therefore it is all important we express our homage unto him. Very soon, maybe in a month's time, already I think there should have been an announcement would have been made, that we are celebrating on the 26th of August, Vyasa Puja, the divine appearance of Srila Prabhupada. So it is the responsibility of one and all to express our homage to Srila Prabhupada. It doesn't matter, no erudition is required. If you feel somebody says, I don't know, I am not learned, doesn't matter. Please write, thank you Srila Prabhupada. That's an offering from our side. Please express this. When we reciprocate, just like Lord reciprocates to us when we surrender, similarly Srila Prabhupada, a divine personality, reciprocates with us. When we start expressing our willingness to follow His principles, His regulations, to render service, He starts reciprocating. So all of you, I request to write your homage and submit it. There is an email which you can inquire from the reception. So, or there are some desks in the reception where you can submit. So please do write, whether it doesn't matter one line or one page. So when we start doing like this, reciprocating with the spiritual master and rendering our service, trying earnestly to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, we will start experiencing all these reciprocations of the Lord. That is very true. So we'll end the class here. If anybody has one question, we can just take before we close, preferably related to today's discussion. Or if somebody has, we can. You had a question?
Hello. The people who occupy public service positions, ministers, chief ministers, prime ministers, as well as government employees, they are all servants of the society, but they somehow have forgotten that over the years in India. Do you have any program which will align the people to come to this realization that serving the people is a way of service to God, so that they can proceed in a very structured process for the years?
See, the answer to this question, whatever program that Prabhupada has given us, it's an universal program. Please be seated. It is not addressing to a particular caste or a creed or a particular society of people. It is universal. Why only talk about government servants? As we have been discussing, we all, a living entity, a jiva, is constitutionally the servant of the Lord. So our business is to serve the Lord. So what Prabhupada has given us is something to come out of the cycle of birth and death, not try to hang over here and then try to satisfy our needs. So many of these questions, as you are asking, like Prabhupada gives an example, a person is hungry. What is your program to go and take care of that hungry child? What do you do? Or many times people ask this question that, you know, what are your charitable in? How are you benefiting the society? As Prabhupada gives example, when a person or a child is suffering from some difficulty, one way of handling the difficulty is you go and help him now. But you can't be going and helping every day. It's impossible. So, but if you are able to understand and realize that that person belongs to a rich father and he has come out of the rich father's association, and you go and take that son back to the rich father, then all his problems are solved. You need not go and take care of him every day. So similarly, now whatever good things that we are talking of, a good society, Rama Rajyam, and no corruption free society, they all have a place in the society. We are part of the society. We all aspire for that. But then, that's not the end of it. What if we have a corruption-free society? Can we go on with our life of sense gratification? No. Prabhupada is addressing at the source. Shastras is addressing at the source. No. Our movement is not meant to settle down here with a good adjustment. We are trying hard to come out of the cycle of birth, death, old age and disease. So we don't want to settle down here. We don't want a good society, good leader. So all this, yes, it is incidental. I am not denying the need of that. But then what the Prabhupada had visioned, what our acharyas have envisioned, is something beyond that. What if we live a good life, this life, next life, we are born as a dog? What accord is the good society when we are not even awarded the human form of life? So our endeavor should be something at a different level, at the subtler level of completely trying to overcome these dualities of life and then going back to Krishna, where we have eternal enjoyment. If any more questions are there, we can take online. We'll end the class here. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Yeah.